I guess when I was born, my mother and father had been married since 1942 and had moved into the house at 59 North Broadway, where his grandparents had retired to and built in, I believe, like 1913. And it was wartime, and my dad was not off at war because of a physical disability. He couldn't go into the service, but he drove an ore truck out near Gabbs. So it was Mom and I at home, and my first memories were her and I walking uptown. It was like two or three blocks, and everything that we knew was within that walking distance, the post office, the stores, grocery stores, and it was always fun to stop at the Sugar Bowl and get an ice cream cone and smell the fresh ground coffee at Safeway. But my favorite thing was the fish pond behind the City Hall. So we would walk down there. That was the fun thing to do. I was probably about three or four. Mm-hmm. But I can remember it real very well.
It's not there now?
It's there, but it doesn't have the fish, and it's been rebuilt, and they've had some problems with it, I believe. But it was fun. When I was four, my grandfather Matthewson had a heart attack, and we had to move to the farm to help him. And that was like 4 miles away from town. And it was on the old Highway 50, what they called Dead Man's Curve. And it was a 90-degree curve in the road, and we'd hear the cars go off, miss the turn every once in a while. There was several people died there, obviously. You know, I don't remember that ever happening, but it's on the corner of today's Harrigan Road and Burney Road where they meet. And Highway 50 doesn't even go near it anymore. But that was where we moved to, and I said I was four. And very shortly after that, this was in August. In October, my little sister, Kathy, was born. So I was sent for a week or two to live with my grandparents, my mother's parents, at Fairview, to the east of Fallon, about 30, 40 miles. Old mining camp, very old. And they were living there. That was what my mother's parents did, was do independent mining in central Nevada. I remember living up on the side of the mountain in the cabin with them. And we got to listen to the radio, listen to the news once a day, twice a day, on the old battery radio and so on. But it was kind of exciting to go up there. And then my mother had been raised in Ione, and so we spent a lot of our childhood going out to that Ione and Ellsworth area that they'd called home, where she'd been educated in the one-room schoolhouse. That whole area out there is, it always feels like going home to me when we do go that way. But the farm was fun because it had old chicken houses and barns and granaries, and there was a honey house and a cellar and an ice house and all kinds of things to explore for little girls to play around in. So as we grew up, it was always fun. We were always learning something from our own explorations of the place. We didn't have cattle or horses, but we had pigs, and my sister and I raised rabbits. They were her project, but she always made me help. And then we had chickens, and so, you know, gathering eggs and helping feed baby chicks and so on.
Sounds wonderful.
In the process, there were four more children born after the first one there. So there were six girls, no boys. My dad had quit driving. Well, he drove truck off and on, had his own for a while. Did several things, but he was a mechanic and a welder, and he worked for the old Dodge Construction Company for years. So that's what he ended up doing. Unfortunately, he died fairly young. He was just 50 years old, and when he passed away from a brain tumor, I was married and had two little babies, but I did help my mother at that point because my sisters were still quite young. And so I spent a lot of time helping her, helping my new husband with his dairy farm, and my father-in-law was there too, but he was quite elderly, so I was helping take care of him and the two babies. And the Mathewson Ranch was the 120 acres that my great-grandparents came in 1909 to. And then when their daughter and son-in-law came, that was where I moved to. It was one of the real old ranches. When my husband and I got married, his farm was the Washburn Farm, which was 1 mile north of the Mathewson Farm. So I moved that 1 mile when I got married. But then our dairy farm was on the Washburn Farm, of course. And we did that for 10 years. But eventually, my husband and I bought the Mathewson Farm from my mother and my uncle. And we just kind of started expanding into different properties from there to get where we are. What prompted the research was mostly the water right issues in the valley. Water rights have been challenged for years here by different entities, the Indian tribes, the government itself, so on. So all of those projects or lawsuits and whatever they were doing required a lot of historical research to prove the ownership of the water right. They did, partially. They came because they had a very ill son, and he had tuberculosis and had to go to the drier, warmer climate from South Dakota. So as a last-ditch effort, they chose this area because of the Newlands Project and the guaranteed water. That was what prompted them in the first place. Because they were in their 50s when they came, which in those days was pretty old to be starting over. Ramona, you were just asking me during a break about water right and water right research. Most of that's carried through the Truckee Carson Irrigation District records and the courthouse records and any other letters and documents that someone stored just because they're probably important. There's a lot of documentation there if one looks, but it all, to be legal, it has to be the recorded type documents. So if you find a letter that says something, then you want to go to the courthouse and find if it was ever backed up. But each property that we bought, because we had added after the Mathewson Ranch and the Washburn Ranch, over the years we've added 3-4 more properties. So we have records on all of those, and my stack of paper is huge. We raise basically alfalfa and corn, rotation crops like rye, different kinds of grain. Usually we make hay with those. But we had sold the dairy cows in 1972 and tried to do without cattle for about 4 years, decided that didn't work. So we started a beef herd. And we've been in the beef cattle business along with the rest of this or ever since then. Here we don't use the big round bales, we use big square bales. But the truckers like them better. The people who are feeding a lot of hay like them better. There's more to a bale. You don't have to load 6 or 7 little ones or more. The little ones are 100 pounds. The big ones are closer to, depending on what baler they come through, they're closer to 1,200 pounds on up. That's why it's the hauling them and moving them. And it also takes less baler twine to wrap up the big bales, so you've got less to recycle. The equipment's changed so much. When we did our Centennial Ranch celebration, we had a party. We had about 150 people there. And I had done poster board, a panel for each 10 years, and started out with a picture of the horses in 1909 to our big tractor that we had in 2009 and all the equipment sequences through that, and as and correlated with a timeline on the family also. So it was an interesting piece that everybody looked at as they came through the gate. But just visualizing that difference, you know, making it real. I can't imagine being anywhere else. You know, this is where I was. This is where I was put. This is where I grew up, and most of my family's here. My children, grandchildren, and I have 11 great grandchildren now. That they're all very close, and my sisters are still mostly around, and so, you know, this is where I belong. I wouldn't want to be anywhere else. And we look at the weather and we always say, this is the best weather on earth right here where we are. And sure, we put up with droughts and we put up with, you know, a lot of things, but it's no different than anyone else that puts up with floods and getting their crops ravaged by bugs or whatever it is. It's part of agriculture. And that's kind of hard work compared to some of the newer ones. But everything is put into, not necessarily concrete ditches, in places there is, but we used to go out with iron rods and pull boards out of the ditch for the water to flow. We don't do that anymore. They're metal gates with actually like a jack on them, and so it's easy anymore, and everything is laser leveled so that the fields are flat and smooth and the water flows evenly, and it is amazing. But that's how things have changed over the years. So, Fallon's been a good place for me. A lot of birds come in when we're irrigating. Deer herds live in there, and we have, you know, and we try to let everything grow. Sometimes this year we had an overabundance of coyotes, but we don't even usually bother them. We've seen coyote litters on the ditch banks and watched them grow, and it's fun to see, because there's you know, that balance in nature that is real important. But I just can't imagine being anyplace else. I love to travel and see other places, but I'm ready to come home always. But it's been a good place, and as we added farms and the boys grew up, the 80s were hard. Interest rates went up, and we had some big mortgages, and it was pretty tough. And so I decided I'd go to work for a while. So I went to work in the savings and loan, and spent some time at that. Got to know a lot of people and how business worked, and other than the farm business. And I took some college classes, mostly finance, bookkeeping, finance, personnel management, human resources, that type of thing. That's what interested me. So I did that, and I just didn't think, I thought, okay, after 3 or 4 years, I'm going to go back to the farm, because I love to run the equipment. I cut hay for 20, 30, no, 40 years at least, and you know, ran tractors and so on. That's what I really like to do. I think it's peaceful, and a pride in doing a good job. So I thought, well, I'll go back to that after we get over this monetary hump that we were in. Well, I really enjoyed my customers, and I was in a customer service position, and it was fun, and I got to know people, and that was an experience then that I wouldn't give up. Well, a couple of my sisters came and said they were kind of at a crossroads in their lives too, and they said, let's open a clothing store. So we got together and we opened a clothing store, me and my sisters, and we had two. There was one here and one in Winnemucca. And we did that for about 3 years, and we discovered that wasn't really what any of us wanted to do. It was fun, and it was a lot of work, and we weren't making any money, but we met more people, and we did we learned a lot more about business and so on. You have to make a business plan. You have to plan ahead for 5-10 years, a long range, but you have to work in a lot of variables, because everything is weather dependent. The prices are set by somebody else. It's the one business that we don't set our prices, someone else sets our prices. It's the buyers, with the market. I took an economics class, and I found that everything in agriculture was exactly backwards from anything else. A business can say it cost me this much to a regular manufacturer, and say it cost me this much to produce this product, therefore I have to add my profit and sell it for this much. Agriculture, the farmer grows his product, his prices of inputs go up all the time, but he can't go into the market and say it cost me this much and I have to make a profit. He has to go to the market and say, what are you going to pay me for it? And that's really the difference. But as far as the government looks at it, you have to file your taxes, so you have to keep these records of what you make and so on. Everyone does it differently. We try to pay ourselves a salary, but since I started working away from home and then into retirement, my husband and I have not paid ourselves a salary for 30 some years. And so, we're living off of retirement funds from outside jobs. Social Security has been kind of a sore subject at our house because I worked in a public service job. So Social Security is gone. They deduct from Social Security for the time that got paid into a public pension fund. And I think that if more of the younger people that are the few younger people that are going into agriculture realize that, they might not go into it either, which would be very unfortunate for this country. Don't be afraid to go farming, but be a little smarter than we were and put some money aside, put it in a 401k or put it in something, whatever program is approved by the government, or even just some kind of a good sound savings account. It is a rewarding lifestyle. As long as you don't have the great expectations of equal paycheck every month, because that's not going to happen. Since our beginnings, we were able to acquire another piece of property that was in between us, in between the two farms, and it has unobstructed view from my living room window for a mile at least, and green fields, cows, trees. I can't beat that. And that's what the Perfecta Vista is. Perfecta Vista is Spanish for perfect view. My mother-in-law had owned the Pahrump Valley Ranch at one time, and that was what the PV was for. She sold that ranch.
What is her name?
Her name was Lois Hatch Washburn. She was Hatch when she owned the Pahrump Valley Ranch, along with her brother. And that was in the 30s, I believe. But when she moved to Fallon and bought the dairy, she kept the PV brand that went with her cattle ranch down there. But she needed to call it something besides Pahrump Valley. So she came up with PV because that Perfecta Vista, because it was still the perfect view at that point. So that's where that came from. And we operate all our various farms under that umbrella name. I did not know my mother-in-law, unfortunately, not well enough to absorb that family history. She passed away when my husband was only 16. I did know her because she was a neighbor, but not to really be involved. But she was a very interesting woman. She'd had a lot of experiences during her lifetime, and she was elected to the Nevada Assembly from Nye County in the 1930s. At the time she was the assemblywoman, she was Lois Dimel. And then she later, I believe in 1936 or thereabouts, married my father-in-law, George Washburn. And he was part of a huge family of Washburns that settled on a farm along the Truckee River near what's today Painted Rock. And they actually worked on helping build the Derby Dam and so on. Some of them did. I guess you call it a political career. That wasn't anything I really planned on. During my years of raising my kids and so on, I got involved with Farm Bureau very deeply. Served a lot of offices there in Farm Bureau and served two terms as the county president, which was kind of unusual position for a woman. Watches out for farmers, basically a legislative organization. We did a lot of what they call policy development, going to the legislature, lobbying for agriculture issues, just keeping farmers informed and involved in politics that will eventually make or break agriculture. So it's a lobbying organization, pretty much. I mean, it does other things, but it's nationwide. It's a national organization, but very grassroots. You start with local meetings and you work up rather than top down. So I spent about 20 years very actively involved in that group. Then I was appointed, I'm trying to remember exactly, but I don't remember when the appointment was, to the old, what they called the Weed and Mosquito Abatement Advisory Committee in this community. And then that actually became a funded district by vote. And then I was appointed to one of the first terms on that. And then I ran for re-election on that and won. That was my first two real political experiences between the Farm Bureau and the Mosquito Abatement District. Kind of got involved. When I was in the position of where I had decided my clothing stores weren't exactly what I wanted to do, I wasn't quite sure what I was gonna do. I thought, well, I'll go back to work or go back to school. I didn't know which. And I thought, well, I'll probably have to go back to work, but I hadn't thought too much about it. My neighbors started stopping at me at weird places, like at my mailbox or uptown in the grocery store or whatever, and telling me I needed to run for the county commissioner seat that was open at that point. Well, I kept telling them, no, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to do that. And one day I thought, why not? I'm not doing anything else. And I thought, well, I probably wouldn't win it anyway because my opposition was a pretty well-known person, a man in the community. And I thought, well, I'll just come up with my $100 and go in and file, which I did. I found out later that my neighbors had actually held a meeting and decided who was going to ask me to do this. But they all got together and put up campaign funds and supported me all the way through. That was in the election of 1994 in November. And surprise, when the November election night came up, I had won the seat. So I really enjoyed it. That was before term limits, and so when the way the law went into effect and so on, I spent 16 years in that county commission position. 12 of it was chairman of the board. It was the best education that anyone could ever imagine. They really oversee the business of the county. everything passes through the commission, one way or the other. And we do the budgets. We hire the department heads, other than the elected ones, of course. Everything passes through that commission. So, and they then were appointed to other boards and commissions throughout the region. I spent one or two terms as a museum, on the museum board right here. I was on, but the big ones I was on was the Carson Water Subconservancy District, which kind of regulates, works on the Carson River. Right now, I still am on the Carson-Truckee Water Conservancy District out of Reno, which is a Truckee River group. I'm on the Nevada Rural Housing Authority still, on their board as vice chairman. And then a lot of other smaller boards throughout the community. We had the Lahontan Valley Environmental Alliance. Right now, I'm still on the Newlands Water Protective Association board. I'm on the Transfer of Development Right Site Selection Committee. I'm still active on that. I was chairman of the road department, county road department, and the what they call the regional transportation authority, the county audit committee. I mean, there's just, you're involved in everything all the time. And that's split up. This county has three commissioners, so we're very busy. But I thoroughly enjoyed that job. I wouldn't have traded that experience for anything. But I'm a very shy person. I found it very difficult to go to the social events. I didn't have a problem with conducting the meetings and going and doing the business end. But socially, I said, I'm very, very shy. I feel that that's what I was born to do. I wouldn't have guessed it. I wouldn't have known it. It's not anything, like I said, that I ever contemplated. But I believe we all have a destiny, that we're things we're supposed to fulfill and do. I think my first accomplishment, best accomplishment, is being a good wife and mother and helping keep the farm business going and intact and growing, because our sons are involved, our grandchildren are involved. You know, we have, and they want to keep it going. There's nobody saying, oh, we don't need that. So I think that's the big accomplishment, but it's not something that one person does. It's part of the community. Each one of these farms, like ours, there's a lot of them, are part of the community. And you have to pull that community together and make that community grow and work. And I feel that, okay, somehow or other, I was supposed to do that, was to help with that. And I think that's what I'm supposed to do, was to somehow or other become this leader that I didn't know I was. I had some ideas that and I worked on. I think one of the important ones was to get a four-lane highway built into here. Took part of, with the university's cooperation and the cooperation of the Navy, getting the what they call the Liberty Fish Pond put in out here, where kids and other people can go. And there's a lot of them. But I think the biggest one that affected this community and will have the longest lasting effect is the Transfer of Development Rights program, where it saves the farms by putting conservation easements on the farms. I was pretty much a leader in that area, and I believe that that's going to have the longest lasting effect on this area. Affects the farms, saves the farms, saves the water, gives the Navy their space that they need to practice and keep their training unobstructed. And believe that in a nutshell is what I would call my biggest accomplishment in that. And I think that that's where it goes. But for and one of my problems, I found one obstacle in the whole process was being a woman. It was very hard because it was breaking into a position that men had dominated within this community. And I found that on a lot of these boards as I went, Farm Bureau, beginning with Farm Bureau and moving on up. Maybe just being at the forefront was the challenge in it. But I feel I've made those accomplishments. And for a girl that's moved 1 mile in her life, you know, I feel good about myself. And I guess my philosophy is something I read a long time ago, is grow where you're planted.